everybody. Welcome to the Disney Countdown Show Season 2.
Woo!
Season 2. My name is Eric Peterson. I am here with my good buddy Danny Jordan. We got Chris Sisley live from Brooklyn. But you may be asking yourself, you may be saying, hey, I'm so excited. Disney Countdown back Season 2. Woo, woo, woo. But when I looked at the link, it was different faces. Danny, have we grown out our hair and gone blonde? Or what's going on here? I'm confused.
First of all, I love that you called it a link. Because
what
it's
would
a
you
show
call
art.
It? A post?
It's a show art.
Okay, sure, yeah. It's a post.
We are so
old. It's a link.
We are so
old. On social media.
And that is why we are making this change. That is why we are bringing in these new hosts. We did not grow out our hair.
We're too old for this.
We're too old for this Disney stuff anymore. I got to raise my kids. I don't know why I was talking like, what's his name? What's the dude who's in like the Western movies with, with Kurt Russell and the guy, Sam Elliott.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
That felt very Sam Elliott in that moment.
Sure. A little deeper though. A little more down here.
Anyway, this is
quality content.
We are coming
here
off the magical rails very, very quickly here. But yes, Eric, it is true. We are passing the Disney baton, as it were, Tinkerbell's wand. I don't know. That feels good, right?
Yes.
Does that feel good?
I like that.
I'm going
yeah.
with that.
The trail of stars and pixie dust behind it.
Yeah, we're just pixie dust now, Eric. That is all we are. Pixie dust in the ether. But yes, we are so excited. Last season one of Disney Countdown, which Eric and I were so grateful to host, to be a part of. We had so many friends who followed us over from Christmas Countdown coming over to the world of Disney. And we had a blast doing it, sharing all these stories from, you know, our past being kids, growing up, loving the Disney parks, and now being dads, raising kids who love Disney as well. But we realized, you know, there are some other people out there who are creating some incredibly happy, magical content. And we thought, you know what, let's bring some new people in. And that is what we are doing here with Season 2, right, Eric?
We are so excited. I'm going to introduce them right now. These are two Disney influencers that I'm sure you are already aware of. But just in case, just to introduce them properly, we are so excited from Countdown Network and the Disney Countdown Show to welcome the Dapper Danielle and Megan, the Magical Millennial, to Disney Countdown Show Season 2. Welcome, ladies.
Yes.
How are you doing?
Hello.
Speak away.
Hello, hello. Oh, welcome to the show. How we doing? Oh my goodness, I don't even know where to really start. Megan, I think you should start us off.
I can do that. No problem, Danielle. I am so excited to host the show and be a part of it and team up with the Dapper Danielle for Season 2. It's going to be so much fun. We have so many exciting countdowns and games and everything. It's going to be a great time. And thank you guys so much for having us, Danny and Eric. Really appreciate it. It's going to be a great season, so looking forward to it.
Absolutely. And I feel like even more recently, me and Megan, we'll talk about this eventually sometime in some other podcast and other episode down the road. Recently, we were in Marceline and we were there together. And the number one request was, oh, my goodness, are you and Megan, are you guys going to be collabing on stuff? And we didn't get the chance to. So this is the ultimate collab that we're going to be doing together for multiple episodes. So this is very exciting to have the representation of the Walt Disney World and the Disneyland side of things. And I'm interested to see what some of our answers and our countdowns are going to be as we continue this on. Yes.
Oh yeah. Coast to coast.
Yeah.
Here's what we didn't tell you is Eric and I hired about 5 people, actors, to go to Marceline and just walk around and find you two and be like, wouldn't it be great if you guys just collaborated on something someday, maybe? And you're like, we haven't really thought about that, but a lot of people seem to be really into it. And then the next day we emailed you and you're like, wow, the universe is talking to us right now.
Sure. That's exactly
how
it happened.
In-person subliminal messaging. Okay.
Yeah. It was money well spent.
Because we make that kind of money as podcasters that we can hire actors to fly to Missouri and do this sort of stuff. Anyway, we are so excited. And for all the fans, you know, who've enjoyed listening, you know, to Eric and myself do this show for, my gosh, Eric, over 20 episodes now, just know that we're not going anywhere. Christmas Countdown is still around. You can still go follow that show. Actually, we are just recording our Christmas in July episode today, so you can check that out. But the Countdown Network family is growing, and we're so excited to welcome Megan and Danielle to the family. So, Eric, I feel like maybe we should hop on the trolley or the train. And
the train is calling.
Go for a ride around the park. What
We're
do you think?
We're going for a ride.
Ladies now have leaving so much Magic fun. Kingdom, or Ooh, not Magic yeah. Kingdom, Main Street, whatever it
yes,
is.
Yes, USA. Oh, I love it. You guys are so awesome. We're going to leave it in your capable hands now, but have fun. You know, as we've talked about before and is so apparent in all of your content that you guys have made, your just genuine love for Disney and joy for life is what this podcast is all about. So have fun. We can't wait to hear your lists of all of your different countdowns. And take it away.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Eric and Danny. Okay. Goodbye. We'll see y'all around. We'll take good care of the kiddos now. It's fine. Well, I guess we should go ahead and introduce ourselves. Y'all, welcome to season 2 of the Disney Countdown podcast. I am the dapper Danielle, and here with me representing Disneyland is...
Megan, the magical millennial.
Yes.
Hello, everyone.
So I guess before we even really get into what our subject and what our topic is going to be for today, definitely go ahead, follow us on the socials, on the Instagrams, on the TikToks, here, wherever you are listening as well. Rate, review, all that other good stuff.
Yep. Disney Countdown Show. And then we do a self-plug as well. Can I do that?
Absolutely,
Am I allowed?
Megan. Do that self-plug. Absolutely.
Thank you. So you can find me, the magical millennial _, on TikTok, Instagram, and YouTube. That's going to be my handle across the board. At the magical millennial _.
Yes. And then for me, it's the dapper Danielle. Yes. The dapper Danielle, as I did the hair flip that you guys can't see over the radio waves right now. And then that's also same thing for TikTok, Instagram, also on the YouTube, though I'm not good about posting on the YouTubes. It's fine. And then here for the Disney Countdown podcast, we do have our own Patreon as well, where as we are growing and continuing the season, we are going to have exclusive content over on that Patreon, where exclusive episodes, maybe even exclusive lists that we will not mention here inside the show. So you never know. There'll be some fun little tidbits over there. But I do think we need to go ahead and introduce ourselves, Megan, to our fam. Yes. Some of these people do know us, but they also don't know how we know each other. And I think let's start off. Who are you, Megan? Who is Megan the Magical Millennial?
Who am I? Gosh, it's something that, you know, you never really think about when you're making content. It's like, oh yeah, these people legit do not know me at all. I just make funny videos and post about the food that I'm eating. It's the parasocial relationship, exactly. So, a little about me. I am, one of the biggest Disney lovers on the planet, as you could probably tell from what I post on all the socials. I live in Orange County, California. I'm actually born and raised here. I've been going to Disneyland since I was about 6 months old. And I've lived in California my whole life. My other interests and hobbies outside Disney, yes, there are some, believe it or not. I grew up playing tennis my entire life. So
really?
that was my sport. Yes. I played tournaments all throughout Southern California. I went to college for tennis, played it there, did NCAAs. And stayed in tennis for work afterwards. I don't know. Fun
really?
Facts.
I'm learning something new about you too, Megan.
That's me. That's a big part of my life. I would say Disney and tennis are probably like the top two things that make up who Megan is. And yeah, I've been living in Southern California, lived in LA for a little bit, for a few years, and I'm back in Orange County. That was a pandemic decision, even though Disneyland did not open for another year. Mm. But I've been an annual pass holder and now a Magic Key holder for about, I want to say, oh my gosh, 20 years, which is crazy. 20 years
That's
in AP.
Amazing.
And we even have a little brick outside of Disneyland with the 50th anniversary medallion on it.
I'm
not going to tell you where.
That.
You got to find it. But our family does have one.
I see. Now, next time I'm over there visiting y'all's coast, I'm going to have to go check out the brick and be like, oh, hello, Megan's family. How are you?
Wave hi.
Yes, absolutely. You know, just go pat the ground randomly and then just walk away. It'll be fine.
That was one of my family's, honestly, we still do that to this day. We'll be like, oh, where's our brick? And I can legit go right to it now, which I'm, you know, pretty proud of. And we'll just say hello and then walk away.
I love that. It's just, that's so funny. I love that so much. Well, I also, just like how you grew up going to Disneyland, I grew up here coming to Walt Disney World. So my family is originally from South Florida in the West Palm Beach, Wellington area. And we would make that like good 2-hour trek over here to Walt Disney World just for like a weekend, whatnot. And even when we moved out of state, we moved to Columbus, Ohio for a little bit portion of my life, we would still come down multiple times to Walt Disney World because that was the Dapper Dad's happy place, right? So I have grown up a Disney kid. It is in my blood. I drank the magic Kool-Aid, all that other stuff. Now, for me personally, though, I wasn't an annual pass holder. I actually became a Disney cast member at the age of 18. So the week before I graduated high school, I went ahead and applied for a job. I actually skipped class to go into my interview. Kids, don't do this. But I skipped class to go to my interview, and then they offer me the job, and they're like, hey, do you want to work for Disney? I'm like, sure. When can you start? Well, actually, I have my senior trip coming up here really soon. And the guy interviewing me looks at me, he's like, wait, you're still in high school? And I said, yeah, but I graduated in like a week. And the rest is history. Oh, so I ended up working for the Disney company for just under 10 years. I made it to my 9.5 year mark. And I ended up leaving the Disney company in November of 2021. And I did a little bit of everything from children's activities, arcade redemption hostess, fairy godmother at the Bippity Boppity Boutiques, and one of my last roles was being a facilitator for Traditions of Our Town, which is the Welcome to the Location class for Disney Springs third parties, and was a trainer and a coordinator for Disney merchandising in Disney Springs. So I have a little random knowledge about multiple things and multiple lines of business. And because of my roles, I was cross-trained all over Disney World. And that's where I really accumulated a lot of my Disney knowledge, is just from my time being there. So, and then the world shut down, right? Just like how you moved in California from LA to Orange County. The world shut down. I was just sitting there twiddling my thumbs, waiting for when Disney World was going to reopen. And we opened up first before Disneyland did.
Way before us, yes.
Way before. And Disney Springs was the very first thing to open up. So I, being one of the highest in seniority, a trainer and a coordinator, I was one of the first cast members called back when Disney World was reopening. Gosh, during that time, though, I started recording on TikTok and started getting on the social media as a way to just like relax. And I would I would make happy videos in my car after my really long shifts working. And that's where random Disney things in the middle of the night that you probably don't care about, but I'm going to tell you anyway, came from, was for me recording in the cast member parking lot in my car around midnight. And the rest is history. It's so crazy that has become a huge part of my life. And now to be able to sit here, do a podcast with people on the other side of the country, this is amazing. It really, really is.
It is pretty incredible. It's crazy to see where this little app has brought us in life. Yes. And just the fact that we can talk about our love for Disney and have that be our thing and have it be a big part of life. I'm truly grateful for it, and it's awesome, really. And it's so fun to get to know a little bit about your backstory and how you got into it, and how the pandemic, the panini, and yes, and TikTok has truly changed your life and our lives
for sure. And so if you to our listeners, as we continue on in our episodes, you'll probably hear me and Megan refer to the pandemic as the panini. This is just out of habit because of AIs and social media and them suppressing certain verbiage. So naturally we just call it, oh yeah, the panini. So if you're new, that's what we're talking about.
it's just a lighter term for something that was a very crazy, dark part of our past.
Exactly.
The past.
Exactly. Yeah. Yes. Well, I guess the next question is that I'm sure people are asking is, again, we're on opposite coasts, and this app and this social media world has brought us together. So how did we actually run into each other? I can't remember.
Okay. Now we were just talking about this, and I thought it was in World. I thought last year when we went to Epcot in February, I thought that you met up with us and that was the first time we met. And I was completely mistaken. That was not the first time that we met. I remember that being a time where we, you know, obviously we were drinking a little bit around the world. So maybe
it was,
I was
a
very
blur
happy.
Anyway.
I was in a very good mood. And that's when we ran into you and I was so happy to see you. And I didn't know if that was because I hadn't met you yet or because you're just amazing and I was so excited to see a friend.
Oh my goodness.
So apologies for thinking that was the first time we met because it was not. Danielle, you know the correct time that we met. And
yes.
When was it?
So we were already mutuals at this point. So we already had followed each other and we started liking a couple of videos through our other friends and connections of people that know other people. And then I went to Disneyland. It wasn't last year. It was already the year before. Was it the year before?
It was 2021. Can you believe that?
Oh my gosh. Oh my God. Okay. Yes. So it was November of 2021 and it was for Dapper Day weekend. And to be fair, Megan, the reason why it was, you probably don't remember, it was because I wasn't wearing my normal clothes. I was literally dressed as a cowgirl.
Yes,
yes,
that's right.
And
yes.
I had all my mm-hmm. fringe on. I was bedazzled out. Fantastic photos, by the way, if you want to go onto my Instagram.
You looked amazing.
And go back. Yeah. Oh, thank you. It's one of my more yes. prouder moments. And we ran into each other and we were just going back and forth, running all around. And I think one of our first major interactions together was we had somebody recognize us on Main Street and we were walking. We were leaving mm-hmm. Disneyland, heading over to California Adventure. And one girl, she was going in full fangirl mode because nobody pictured the two of us being together in the same spot. And that was
yep.
such a cool moment. And I loved that so much. I still think about that a little bit. But I didn't realize that that was the first time we really met each other and we were really hanging out. So this is so cool yep. to be able to do this on the podcast now and just be able to talk with you. The ultimate collab is what
the
this
ultimate
is.
Collab. That's right. That's right. We got a lot of requests over the last couple months to do some sort of collab, and this is the ultimate collab. But I want to bring up so that evening, by the way, I was super excited to have met you for the first time, and you looked incredible. I want to bring up a little story, one of my more embarrassing moments at Disneyland. So it was Dapper Day, and I don't necessarily do Dapper Day. I think that was my first time dressing up for Dapper Day in our park. That was my first time, and so I decided to do it. That evening, we were about to have dinner at Cafe Orleans, and I decided to walk into the perfumery, which is right across the way. And because I saw these outfits on these people that I just loved. They looked incredible. So I walked up to them because I was trying to do a little YouTube video. I was also new to YouTube and I was vlogging. And I asked this guy, hey, would you mind like just posing and me showing your outfit for this YouTube video that I'm doing? And he looked at me and he's like, well, you have to like ask the boss man. So I went over to another guy who looked incredible and I asked him and he was super sweet, was like, absolutely. And he did a few poses. And I didn't realize it, but he was standing next to a woman who was dressed to the nines, looked also amazing in her all black. And it happened to be Dita Von Teese. And
you met Jay and Dana Von Teese?
Yeah. Again, I'm not like super into the dapper and also like the pinup style, but I didn't recognize her at first. And then I realized that I was behind her and then I walked out and everybody was freaking out that she was in the park. They had just found out she was in the park. And I'm like, wait, that she's right there. Do you want to go meet her?
Like, that's so funny.
So I had asked her, one of her friends and I guess the dapper guy, just to be in my silly little YouTube video without knowing who they were.
So I love that.
Yeah, that's one of my more embarrassing moments of Disneyland. But it was fun. And they're really nice.
Right. And honestly, I would not be able to, besides just her being dressed up and fabulous, for those that are not aware, she is very much into the vintage aesthetic, some of the burlesque side, but also like just very much she's a model, all this other kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And then Jay is the guy that actually started Dapper Day. And if you want to read his entire story, definitely go to dapperday.com. And on the bottom, there's a little section that says our story and it tells how he created and why he created Dapper Day. And it's very, very intriguing, the whole story and how this came about and how this has really only been around since like 2010-ish. And it's grown to what it is today.
All right, now it is time to talk some Disney news.
We interrupt our program to bring you this
Disney news.
Yes.
Yes, we do have a couple things that we need to talk about today, and that is our topic of the Billboard Top 100 and what they consider are the top Disney songs of all time. There are some hits, there are quite a few misses, and me and Megan decided we had not communicated with each other about this topic because we are very heated about it.
We're saving our passion for right now.
Yes, there might be a little bit of rage that comes out as we continue into this topic, and it is about Disney music. Specifically, here recently, I believe it was May 27th of this year, Billboard released what they considered was the top 100 Disney songs of all time for the 100-year anniversary. They are wrong. All of their choices are wrong, is basically what we're going to talk about.
It's all wrong. It's all messed up. I don't know what I don't know what happened.
I don't know how we should even explain to this. So there is a list. If you go onto billboard.com, you can actually see this entire list is one of the number one topics. It has actually been a big enough debate that this list has actually popped up on like the music side, the regular generic side of YouTube. And of all of these analytical musicians and like all these other people are breaking down this list, and they also don't agree with this list. What is a good example? Was there any in particular that you're just like, absolutely, Megan?
Yes. Number one. Let's just talk about the number one glaring issue that I see with this. And some people like it. I don't understand it. It's a Small World is at number three. And I have so many thoughts and feelings about that because number one, it's associated with the ride, and I get it. The ride's a classic. The ride is a classic. Yes. However, there's so many other good songs.
Do you
songs.
Know why like, it's at number three?
Because it's a classic. I couldn't tell you anything more than that.
It is the most played song in the world.
What?
Yes. So if you were to Google, like if there's a song that has been played more times in like repetitive. So it is counting for the attraction on multiple coasts, just playing the song over and over and over again. It is the most played song in the entire world and is probably the most recognizable amongst different like languages. And like, if you even just hear the tune, no matter where you're from, you will probably know it's a Small World.
Okay. So if it brings people together like that, then it makes more sense.
Right.
And I understand.
But that's only if you know the history behind it. So from anybody else, they're just like, yeah, no, why is this song here? And I would agree. It is very impactful. It is a very huge staple in the 1964 World's Fair. Does it belong in the number three? I don't think so.
No. Top 10, you could put in the top 10, sure. But number three, top five, top three is... That's a decision for me that I would love to talk to the person who created this list or the team that created this list and just ask why.
Yes.
So there's that. And then there's also the fact that no Tarzan song, not one Tarzan song made the top 100. You'll Be in My Heart is in the top, 50, I think? It's somewhere in there. You'll Be in My Heart. That's the only one. There are so many other Phil Collins creations that could have been in there. Strangers Like Me, I feel like, should have been the one to at least be in this list. But yeah, You'll Be in My Heart was the only one.
Oh, yes. Well, if you want to, go ahead and check out the Billboard Top 100 so you can see this full list as we're talking about this as well. I will warn you, the list is, there's a lot of ads playing on the Billboard website. It did crash my browser once. So I do think we will be taking the regular list that I've created for me and Megan, and we'll probably post it over somewhere just so that way it's easier for you to access and you can read it easier. And then we'll also add some additional notes from our list over there too. But let's go ahead and break down what Billboard, their top 100, and what they thought should be in the top 10. Do you want to tell them what the number 10 was?
Yep. Let's go to number 10 right here. We have the ever so classic Breaking Free from High School Musical, which is from 2006.
You know,
Over Eye to Eye. Sorry, I'm bringing all these like other song references up and I'm just like, really? Breaking Free?
You know,
when I was, how old was I in 2006? Oh my gosh, I'm going to age myself. 14. I was 14 years old. And I love that song at 14. Now, Zac Efron's not actually singing that song. So let's lift the curtain on that one. It's Drew Seeley. He's singing that with Vanessa Hudgens. Mm-hmm. And it was a great song, and I really enjoyed performing it for my family when we had friends over and we do our little shows after mm-hmm. dinner.
Yes.
But in the top 10 of all time Disney songs, no, I'm going to have to say no to that one. Danielle, how do you feel about that?
Because I feel like this list should have been more based off of, like, when you think of the Disney company or as Disney as a whole, what are the top 10 songs that you hear and you immediately associate, oh my gosh, it's Disney. I do not associate High School Musical with, like, Disney as a brand, even. Like, maybe Disney Channel and, like, nostalgia OG vibes, yes, but not Disney as a brand and as a whole, right?
Agreed.
Number nine.
It's its own thing.
Mm-hmm. I think this is a little more understandable. A Spoonful of Sugar from Mary Poppins, 1964, is number nine. I think that is okay. I'm glad Mary Poppins
love that song.
Got some representation.
Yeah. We love Mary.
We love mm-hmm. Mary. One thing
yes.
I added in my notes that I was very upset about is that Walt Disney's favorite song did not end up in anywhere in the top 100.
Can you remind me of what that was?
Feed the Birds.
Oh, I love that song. Okay, yeah. Wow.
Feed the Birds.
It's not at all in this list?
It's not in the list at all.
Wow.
I had to do a double take because I'm like, okay, obviously these are not Disney people because they don't even know Walt Disney's favorite song. For those that do not know, Walt Disney, when the Sherman Brothers created the Feed the Birds song, it became his song to the point where the Sherman Brothers would come in on Friday afternoons into the working office there at the animation studio. They would sit down. There is a couch over there, and they would just have scotch just sitting there on the couch, just talking, chatting it up. And then Walt would turn to the boys and say, hey, can you play it? And Richard knew exactly what it was and would go to the piano and would play Feed the Birds. And even after Walt passed away, Richard Sherman is still the only one that is allowed to enter into the office and even touch the piano.
Really?
So when he passes, no one else will be allowed to touch the piano. Right?
Wow, that's super special.
And
okay.
So when Walt passed, he would even go in and on Friday nights, even though Walt wasn't there, he would just start playing Feed the Birds into an empty office. Isn't that awful? It's like so sad to think about. But the fact that that song didn't make it into the list, like, trash. Goodbye. But I am happy that...
alone, trash.
Trash. But I am so happy that at least Spoonful of Sugar ended up on this list. And then Supercalifragilistic did also, but it was like somewhere in the 30s.
That is... Yeah. You're right, 37.
Good memory. See, I've been staring at this list for too long if I'm remembering
She's
that.
She's been studying away for I this have moment.
Been. I have been. Okay,
so and going then... to, yeah, next one is kind of similar on the same spectrum as High School Musical. It's The Climb from Hannah Montana.
Like,
and
I get it.
Don't get me wrong. We love Hannah. I had a big Hannah Montana phase back in the 2000s, but...
I don't
know.
No.
Not top 10.
Mm-mm. Not top 10. And my reasoning for this is that, the song has over 464 million plays on the music video on YouTube. I understand
it's
that.
Very impressive.
Very impressive. Mm-hmm. However, The Climb itself was basically Miley Cyrus's goodbye song from the Disney company into her own self. Is what I associate it with. So I view it as a goodbye song. So I don't even put it into the Disney category. I don't know why this is here at 8.
it's number 8. Like, that's wild to me.
Absolutely.
It's a good karaoke song, I guess.
Is it? Well, it's for, I don't know. Every time I've heard this song in karaoke, it's to that one girl that thinks that she can sing. And then she gets up to the microphone.
She can belt.
And she like very dramatic about it. And she waltzes on up to the microphone and she's like, I can almost see it. Yeah, that's all I can picture whenever I hear this song. And I'm like, no, cringe. Goodbye.
That's a pretty good representation. A good visual, I think. Yeah.
Thank
accurate.
You. I hope I embodied that image perfectly for y'all.
I appreciate that. Yes.
Well, now number 7, understandable. Also another really great Disney history song. And that is the Mickey Mouse March.
Right. I understand that. I get that. Yeah.
I understand that. I get that. Now,
that
my brother,
classic Disney song.
Oh, yes. Now, my brother is, he currently works in the music industry in Nashville, and he works for a record label and everything. And they went through this list also, and he was shocked at the amount of people that did not know the Mickey Mouse March. He was the only person in his entire office that knew what it was, and he had to sing it for everybody. But he grew up a Disney kid. So if you grow up in the Disney community as like more of the movies and stuff, I don't think they have an association with the song.
No, they don't. Mm-mm.
Right?
And this is a deeper cut, I guess, Mickey Mouse. It's Mickey Mouse Club, you know? So if you're not a true, like, or not true, but more of a hardcore Disney fan like we are, this is more of an, it's more of an elusive song. It's not really played as much. I grew up listening to it all the time because it was on the albums that we played in the car. So. Right. I heard this, watched Disney Channel back in the day, and it sometimes would play on there. But it's not in any sort of movie or anything.
It's not. So and that. even in the parks, it has very little representation inside the parks. But for me, like just like you, it was on like the Disney favorite CDs that we would play in the car as a family and whatnot.
Yep.
And then for my family, we would go to Fort Wilderness Campground. And they have a sing-along with Chip and Dale. And the cowboy's the one that stands up there on the stage. And he's just strumming his guitar. And this was the song that they would close out every sing-along with there for a while. And that's how I grew up on this song. So, like, I understand it. But this is one that I do think it should have been in the top 20 for the historical impact. But I don't even know if this should make it into the top 10. That's a good debate piece.
Oh, interesting. Okay. You know, I understand it. It wouldn't make my top 10 for sure, but right. I understand it in terms of like the Disney songs of the world. But speaking of world, the next one, number 6, I completely understand being in top 10, and I would put it there is A Whole New World from Aladdin.
Exactly. I agree.
I that needs no explanation. I think that deserves a top 5 spot, to be honest.
Oh yeah.
That might be one of the most streamed songs on Spotify, I'm pretty sure.
Yes.
One of the most played.
I was going to say, it's probably one of the top also wedding songs, you know?
Yes. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Speaking
of
wedding
songs. I love the acoustic versions.
Oh, yes, the acoustic versions. Ukulele version of this song. Have you heard the ukulele version?
I haven't, no.
I will send that to you. Maybe I'll post that somewhere for y'all, because it is so good and it's so relaxing to listen to. It was used in an ad for Alani a couple years ago, like back in like 2016.
Yes,
and
I love that.
Beautiful, beautiful version. It's probably one of my favorite versions of this song. But number 5, I don't agree with this one. I love this song. I actually think it should be higher up on the list than where it's at.
Oh, you think it should be towards number 1 more?
Like 1 or 2.
Oh, great. Okay.
Okay. Go ahead. I knew we were going to agree on this one. When You Wish Upon a Star is at number 5.
It's one of my favorite Disney songs as well. Yeah.
It is the iconic Disney song. So like even in the opening scenes of every Disney movie where they show the castle, it's the da, 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 da. And that's everybody knows this song. Even if they don't know the lyrics.
That is a classic Disney song. And I love Jiminy Cricket. And I love that song. Gives me chills. Yeah, it is iconic. True. And then the next one, I don't know if I agree with this.
Ooh, yes, continue.
The next one is from actually one of my favorite princess movies, Beauty and the Beast, and it's Be Our Guest.
You know what song did not make this list?
Is it from the same movie? Is it? Don't tell me it's Beauty and the Beast.
Beauty and the Beast, sung by Angela Lansbury, is not even anywhere in the top 100. It is not anywhere on this list. This song and then the Belle score from the opening of the movie is on the list.
Oh my God, my face just got red.
The Beauty and the Beast song, the Tale as Old as Time song, is not anywhere in the 100.
I'm done. That's it for me.
You're good. Okay, this has been a great podcast. We're going to leave now. Thank you. Goodbye. No.
I'm going to write a strongly worded email to Billboard being like, some choice words for you.
Choice words. So Be Our Guest. Fantastic song. We love a good Jerry Orbach moment. But, and then we just mentioned it a little bit earlier. Number 3 is It's a Small World, which we understand, but we don't agree with.
We understand now. No. Mm-mm. And then number 2, I don't think this comes as a surprise to anyone that this is in the top 10. It's Let It Go from Frozen. Do I think it deserves a number 2 spot? No. I do think it might be top 10 for a lot of people. It's not for me. I'm kind of in the boat of a lot of parents where I'm just so sick of that song.
Do you know why we're so sick of it? Let me give you some numbers. Let me give you some numbers. This song has been played on Spotify over 655 million times.
Ooh.
The music video clip of it that was posted to Disney Channel UK, that if you go and you search Let It Go, it is the first video to pop up. That song in that video has been played 3.4 billion times.
Oh, she said the billions.
Billions.
Wow.
That is why this song is up here. That is why this is like the song. However, I would agree with you that I don't know if this should be in the top 10 only because Will Let It Go stand the test of time like When You Wish Upon a Star does.
Right.
Right. So we're just now celebrating the 10-year anniversary of Frozen. Will the Frozen Empire continue, which I mean, it probably will, but will that song continue and age gracefully like some of these other songs?
I just think we're getting some people are getting a little bit tired of it. And I don't think that happened with A Whole New World or Colors of the Wind. I don't know. It might. Especially the kiddos love it still. So, I just don't agree with that one. Danielle, I'll give the number one to you.
Why are you giving this one to me? It's my least favorite princess, which is sad.
Really?
Now I will explain this later on of why she is my least favorite. The number one spot on the Billboard Top 100, what they think is the number one song, is Part of Your World from The Little Mermaid, the 1989 movie. I think this was put in there simply as a marketing tool for the new Little Mermaid movie, which, understandable, fantastic. Yeah. But at the same time, no. I see it as the placement was completely a marketing tool. Now, Part of Your World, fantastic song. Should it be in the top 20 or even the top 10? Absolutely. Iconic song. But no, Ariel's my least favorite princess.
That is so interesting. She was my favorite princess for a long time growing up as a little kid. Because I love mermaids. I wanted to play mermaids all the time.
Who doesn't?
Part of Your World is definitely, I'd say, top 10, top 20 for sure. Number one, I wouldn't agree with number one as well. And that's the reason we're here, you know, to talk a little bit more about that and what we might put as our top 10.
Now, I've mentioned a couple of songs, right, that didn't even make the list. For example, Feed the Birds, Beauty and the Beast did not make this list. Can I give you my list of other songs that did not make this list at all?
I would love to. Please tell me, because I have some too.
Try Everything from Zootopia.
Oh, I love that song. I sing it all the time in the car.
Yeah. Yep. With over 724 million plays on Spotify, it should have been on the list.
724. We love Shakira. I mean, Shakira is like that. She did a really good job with that song.
Try Everything was the song I would play right before I walked into like an interview or a major meeting at Disney. And that was my hype up song. That was the only way I survived.
I do love, and that's the message behind it. It's like, just go at it. Don't be afraid to fail. Just literally try everything. Try what you want to try.
And I don't know if you noticed this too, Megan, is that there are only two orchestra pieces in this entire list.
What are they?
Belle, the opening score for Beauty and the Beast.
Oh, yes. Okay.
And the other one is, what was it? Oh, it's the Soaring soundtrack.
Yeah, I just looked at that right here.
So
number 49. Number 49. Wow. Okay.
Right. But out of all the orchestra pieces, out of the songs that did not make this list, He's a Pirate did not make this list.
Ooh, which one's that? I'm so sorry. Oh my god! But the pirate song.
Pirates of the Caribbean song. The you hear it and it forces you to go into a Jack Sparrow run across the yard.
Instantly.
You immediately go into Jack Sparrow pose as soon as you hear the song. This did not even make the top 100.
That's mind blowing. And Soarin' did. That's pretty crazy.
And Soarin' did. Right. What's one of the songs that you're angry didn't even make the list?
Again, I'm so pissed about my Tarzan songs not being on there.
Megan's like, this is the hill I am going to die on.
I will never let them live it down. There is one, I'll talk about it later, of course. I'll mention it a little bit later, but it's mostly just the order of everything just gets to me a little bit. And there was one I was just thinking of, and I can't remember.
So
but...
some other ones that did not make the list. The Alice in Wonderland, Unbirthday did make the list. However, in The Golden Afternoon, which I feel like is kind of even more iconic, I associate that with Disneyland more so than anything, did not make the list.
Yeah, that's in our ride. I love that song.
Mm-hmm. Go the Distance from Hercules, which is one of the number one. Yes, one of the number one played songs on that like album didn't make the list.
Yes,
Zero to Hero. I don't think is on the list. Is Zero to Hero?
No. I think is the only one. I Won't Say I'm in Love. Is that on there?
Yeah.
Oh, there it is. 45. I think that's the only Hercules song. So done. Same thing as Tarzan.
Trash.
Like, trash. Right. And then the other one, and forgive me if I'm wrong, but I did not see it. I love Hunchback of Notre Dame. That is a movie that is like my childhood. Where are all the Hunchback songs?
No Hunchback songs. So not even...
Out there.
The iconic song that... Oh,
it's in Wonder's Journey. Isn't it in... It's in Happily Ever After, right?
It is in Happily Ever After. And okay, so story time. I do have fantastic memories to that song because when Happily Ever After came out and it first went to Disney World and whatnot, at the time I was a fairy godmother at the Bippity Boppity Boutiques. Mm-hmm. And I would pick up shifts at the castle. And since we got off earlier in that weird break before everybody else did, we would actually be exiting through the utilidors underneath the Magic Kingdom as the fireworks were going off. And so imagine this flutter of fairies in these giant purple skirts and their little halos and these like little red vests just fluttering around because they also played the music into the utilidors as well. And we would always walk out underneath the castle at the same time that Out There was playing. And then you have these flutter of fairies doing the most dramatic interpretive dance through the utilidors, singing along to the song. And then as you exit, you are looking out the back of the utilidor, you are looking up to where the fireworks launch. Is it a safety hazard? Probably, but it's gorgeous. And it's so
beautiful.
I have fantastic memories associated with that song because of that fireworks show. And the fact that this did not make the top 100. Again, flames on the side of my face.
It just blows my mind over some of these songs that are on there, again, from Cheetah Girls. I'm sorry to be ragging on Cheetah Girls.
But none of your Ratatouille songs either made it on there.
La Festa, like, why not? You know? La Festa, like, that's...
Even just the Ratatouille main theme song, which swells so much emotion, did not make this list.
That's crazy.
The end credits from The Incredibles or Life's Incredible Again didn't make the list.
Okay. Yep.
Clearly, we have feelings, so if you want to hear all of our hot takes, our hot Mad Hatter tea on this list, definitely go check out our Patreon, where we'll be sharing the full uncut audio over there, plus the top 10 list of what we think Billboard should have done for their top 10.
Unfiltered, raw content.
Absolutely, yes.
So if you want access to all of that, the link is going to be in the episode notes, or you can search on Patreon, Disney Countdown Show. And now...
I think we need to pause for a second, Megan. I think we need to breathe for a second, and we need to compose ourselves.
Deep breath together.
Just breathe in, breathe out. And do you want to play a game? Should we play a game here for a second before we go into our list of what we think should have been the top
10? I would love. 10? Yes, yes. Please, let's take our mind off of this for a moment and let's play a little game. I'm ready.
Relax. Chris, are you still there with us? Are you listening in? Can you help us enter into this game that we're going to play today?
I am here. It's a shame that Danny and Eric abandoned me, but I'm here with you, and now we're going to be best friends.
I think we're delightful, Chris. We'll try not to scare you.
Did anyone else notice that they just totally left me here?
It's fine. You know, it's just okay. Like dropping off the kid
at
daycare.
We'll keep you company, Chris.
It's okay.
Yeah, we're here for you.
We'll always have Christmas. So we're going to be playing a game called Disney Taboo. Sweetest Taboo. Which
obviously we know is the sweetest of taboos.
Oh my.
The way this is going to work is before we recorded, I sent over some Disney characters to Danielle and Megan, and they're going to have to do their best to get the other person to guess what character they are trying to describe, but they cannot use four specific words that would make it too easy for them to get it.
Okay.
So we can start. We'll just start with Danielle. You're going to be describing to Megan.
Danielle, I just want to say
what?
This taboo. This is my game. This is my game.
Okay,
I'm ready.
I'll try not to let you down. Okay, I'll try. I'll try. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Pumpkin carriage.
Cinderella?
Yes. We got this. Let's go. Okay. Okay, I'm ready.
Okay. I'm a little nervous for mine. Jeez, that was really good. Okay.
Okay.
All right. This is tough. Aurora villain.
Maleficent.
Yeah.
Hey. Yeah. Okay. To infinity.
Buzz Lightyear?
Yes.
Bro, steamroll right through these.
I don't know, Chris. You might have to make this a little harder for next time. Let's continue.
Don't even say it. They will be so hard next time.
Okay. I love a good challenge. This is just a warm up in the first episode. That's what we're doing.
Sure.
Green dress.
Tiana?
Yeah.
Very nice. Okay. Yellow dress.
Belle.
Yeah. I like the little Mickey.
Let's see. Guppy Finn.
Oh, Flounder. Oh.
I
say you said Guppy or like
anemone.
Oh, Nemo.
Yeah.
Okay. Ooh. Grandmother Willow.
Pocahontas?
Yes.
Let's go. All right. Okay, this is a good one. Piglet's best friend.
Pooh Bear?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Oh goodness. Not Lizard. I don't do that tongue thing. Mulan, yes.
That was a really good Mushu.
Yes.
But okay, yes, the princess, of course. All right. I'll make sure I can't say this. Haunted Mansion Holiday.
Jack Skellington?
Yeah.
Okay. Fabulous.
Well done.
This is more of like a phrase or a sentence. Is that allowed?
You can't. So it's not like password is when you can only do one word. But okay. Taboo, you can like sentence it. Yeah.
Okay. The only main character in a Disney film not to talk in their own Disney film.
Dumbo?
Yes.
That's my favorite character.
The only character where he is the main title, but he does not say a single word in his entire movie. See, that's how you know. Right. Megan knows her Disney trivia. Okay. Chris, challenge accepted. We expect some harder options next time. And I'm so excited for the next time, too. That was fun. That was a good little break. And mixed. That made me very happy. And
wait,
delighted.
Danielle, I have one more.
Oh, you have one more.
One more. Sorry.
Okay. I got so excited.
Okay. Oh gosh. Oh. Captain.
Oh, Jack Sparrow.
Yeah. Yes. That's all I needed to say.
The hand motion thing too that they can't see right now, but yes, it's the hand motion as well. You know, Captain Jack Sparrow. You just have to put the hands up, like little octopus hands up here at the top, and then you know exactly who it is.
It's like the hands right up here.
Yes.
Captain Jack Sparrow.
I love that. Yes. Yeah. Well, I think that was a really fun. That was a good break to make us relax after talking about such a heated topic that is the Billboard Top 100. Now, Megan, as we go into breaking down what we think our top 10 are, did you make your list based off of personal preference or based off of Disney business preference?
I love that you have both lists probably on your computer right now.
My personal list is not completely written out. However, I could definitely pull that out of thin air. But I was having a very hard time with this because my personal feelings definitely got in the way of what I think are my top 10, because I would not necessarily go to and listen what I think the top 10 songs of like the Disney company are. So again, that argument that I used of when you think of the Disney company a little bit earlier, I mentioned this, when you think of Disney, when you are walking into the front gates of Magic Kingdom or Disneyland, and they have that song, the playlist that plays that doesn't have the lyrics of the songs, it just has the instrumental versions, and you hear this song, and it triggers those emotions of nostalgia and magic and everything. Do these songs fit into that category?
Yeah.
Is that what you did for your list as well?
They can, absolutely. My list is for sure. It's my personal list. It's a super subjective, and it's definitely songs that are nostalgic for me. They definitely trigger emotions and have honestly gotten me through some tough points in my life. So I for sure went personal. I do not have any of my objective song list.
Then I think you should start us off, because then I have to switch lists. And I think what I'll do is that I might take what I think is the top 10 list, or maybe if I continue onward, if I go down a rabbit hole and I continue this list, that list will be officially posted onto the Patreon page and whatnot of what we think should have been the top 10 for the Disney company as a whole.
I love
that. I think you should start us off. While I'm pulling this up, you start us off.
Absolutely. I could definitely start off. And just a reminder, guys, we will be doing 10 through 6 in this episode. We will be doing 5 through 1. So catch our top 1 in the next week. And make sure to subscribe so that you are staying on top of it and you can see what Danielle's and my top 10 lists are.
Exactly.
All right, so I'm going to get started with number 10. Da, 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 da. All right. This is good. I think my list is super personal. Like, I don't think anyone's going to agree with mine, but number 10 for me is...
That's me as well, because again, super niche, super opinionated. This is the girl that loves Country Bears and Muppets when a lot of people don't. So, you know, my list choices and song choices are also going to be very obscure. So if we might need to play any clips later on in post editing or whatever, we might need to do that so you guys know what song we're even talking about maybe. So yes, what is your 10? What is your 10?
So number 10 for me is When Somebody Loved Me from Toy Story 2. Probably one of the saddest songs in a Pixar movie, and it for sure just triggers all the emotions. I love to sing that song. I think Sarah McLachlan's voice is absolutely beautiful, and it's just a very emotional part of that movie. So I think it's a beautiful song, and that's why it is my number 10.
That is a good choice. That is a really good choice. Yeah. All the feels right there. Oh gosh. I would have, so a song, I actually talked to you about this on the live stream that we did the other night on TikTok. Probably another song that also gets me a little emotional whenever I hear it. However, it's not a sad song. And it's not part of a favorite Disney movie or anything like that for most people. A lot of people don't like this movie at all. Is Home on the Range, right? The song Little Patch of Heaven from Home on the Range, the movie, is probably in my top 10. Now, the unfortunate thing is that Little Patch of Heaven is not available on most streaming services for some reason. I don't know if it's something with the copyright or what it is, but whenever I hear that song, either sung by somebody else or whatnot, I get emotional. And that would be my 10 spot right there.
I love that. And that's super niche. Because Home on the Range is perceived as not the greatest animated Disney movie. But I love that.
Totally slept on.
Oh my gosh. Yes. Okay. That's amazing. All right, so number 10, there we go. Let's move on to number 9, and we did I did reference this as one of my favorites in the Billboard list. So number 9 for me is I'll Make a Man Out of You from Mulan, because it is a top 10 Disney song.
It is.
And it for sure deserves a spot. And whenever it comes on, I play my Disney playlist all the time when I'm on a long distance drive. When that one comes on, it will stay on and I will sing along to it and Donny Osmond all the way, because it's just amazing.
Yes.
Well, so,
and it's the song where Jackie Chan sings the, is it the Mandarin or Cantonese version of the song? So
yes.
If Jackie Chan's singing it, why is this not in the top 100 or top 20s at least?
Oh. Couldn't tell you. Couldn't tell
Goodness,
you. But we've been through
that. That is a fantastic, fantastic choice. And
thank
now,
you.
That's a song where no matter who you are, bros, whatever, like that song comes on in any location. The toughest of the tough guys, as soon as that song turns on, they go hard at it. They are totally belting and yelling at that song. So yes, I would agree. Definitely deserves to be.
It's one that like there on TikTok, there's been some like punk rock versions of it that are just like make me want to lift 1,000 pounds. Like I'm like
the
so screamo fired up.
Version.
Yes, it's so good.
So
it feels like a grunge version. Yeah.
Yes.
Oh. So I'm a huge fan of that one. That's number 9 for me. How about you, Danielle?
Oh gosh. Okay. So number 9 for me is going to be from one of my favorite Disney attractions that's here newer. Nothing Can Stop Us Now.
Oh no. Really?
Oh my gosh. Girl, when I go in to the Chinese theater here at Hollywood Studios in Disney World, I go waltzing on in. You go into the little movie theater section, and then it's like, you are here to watch Mickey's picnic and whatnot with the little cast member that does the opening spiel. And as soon as like the lights dim and it goes into that blaring version of Nothing Can Stop Us Now, I lose my mind, and I'm just standing there, and I'm just bopping or just bouncing up and down.
It's
just like going at it at the song. And that song, once you hear it once, will be stuck in your head for the rest of the day. That has become my It's a Small World song. Like I can block out It's a Small World now. That is just out of habit. But when Nothing Can Stop Us Now comes in, I'll start randomly singing it 5 hours later afterwards, and it'll just pop in out of nowhere. That is probably my number 9.
I think you speak for like almost all the people that visit Disneyland every day. If you go on Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railway, you're going to be singing that song for the next couple hours, because it is so catchy and it is a bop. I'll do my little shoulder dance when I hear it, especially in the promenade or on the ride. Oh yeah.
Go into a little hot dog dance right there in the middle of Main Street. Absolutely.
Yep.
And now
they play the instrumental in Toontown. Oh yeah.
Yes. Oh my God. See, and we, of course, we don't have Toontown here in Walt Disney World, and I have not been to Toontown since it reopened in Disneyland.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
one of the main reasons why I'm even trying to make a trip out there sooner than later is specifically to go to Toontown and ride y'all's version of Runamuck Railway. And
in the El Capitan Theater.
In the El Capitan. I love the references. And just to find all the hidden Mickeys. And I need to go with, have you been able to find all the hidden nuances in the ride yet?
In the ride itself, no. In the queue, quite a bit.
Okay.
Yes.
See, and y'all's ride is laid out a little bit differently of where the end scene is. Like a lot of our scenes are on the left.
Yeah.
A lot of yours are on the right. So I need to go and just ride it do a wrap around and ride it like 3 or 4 times so I can catch everything possible. But yes, so I'm very passionate about this song at number 9.
Hey, I get it. I totally get it. All right. Let's see. Number eight. And this one for me, I get chills every time, especially with all the different versions of it. I absolutely love it. It's How Far I'll Go from Moana. My best friends is just the biggest Moana fan, and seeing the movie with her was it brings back so many happy, joyful memories. Honestly, it gives me chills thinking about it. I think it's a genius song with great lyrics, and then the reprise towards the middle of towards the end of the movie, actually they play it in World of Color, and that is my favorite part of the show. It literally thinking about it again, chills. So that's that deserved a top 10 spot for me. And that's why, yeah, I put it at number 8. I just love it.
Goodness. I do. There are a lot of Moana songs that I really do love. Now, it didn't make into my top 10, but I would say in Moana, it would probably is the version of I Am Moana, and not her singing I Am Moana, like her repeating her name over and over again. It's only
that
the
part.
Only,
specific, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the only segment I like is Grandma talking to her and asking, Moana, listen, do you know who you are? And that part gives me chills. So no, I understand that. There are some really great songs in Moana, and I'm happy that made your, that was your number 8, right?
Yes, number 8. Mm-hmm.
My number 8, for no reason in particular. It's only because when I heard this song and I was younger, I wanted to learn all the words to it because I thought it was so cool. It is Substitutionary Locomotion from Bedknobs and Broomsticks.
Wow. That's a deep cut right there.
Yes.
Whoa.
And so when I was younger and I first, I really loved this song. So whenever, this movie in general, I really actually enjoy. And that's a deep cut movie. But whenever I go into the Living Seas or the Seas with Nemo and Friends in Epcot, and we're just walking through the aquarium area, immediately in my head, I'm just singing, bobbing along among the bottom of the beautiful briny sea. That's me.
That's so good.
Thank you. Because I love the movie so much. So when I was younger, I learned her entire spell of Draguna, Macoides, Trachorum, Satis D. And that is one of the songs I really, really want to do in like a video come like Halloween time, because she is a witch technically. And I want to do a whole recreation of the shoes moving, and another Angela Lansbury classic
love
song.
Love her.
Yes. So again, another really, really deep cut.
I love Bedknobs and Broomsticks and Angela Lansbury. That's that's awesome.
I'm salty that is a Broadway show playing over in the UK and we don't have it over here on our coast.
Well, it needs to make its way on over then, because I would love to see that.
Or at least some like really great theater company. If a theater company like with the right budget that can make this happen, I will go see it. Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. Of course. That's so awesome. All right. So moving on to number 7. This is for sure a classic. So got another one from Mulan. It is Reflection. And it is another one that when it comes on, I will belt along to, whether it's the old Christina Aguilera version or the new one or Mulan's version from the movie. Yes. And Ming-Na, no, it's not Ming-Na Wen. It's, oh my gosh, now I'm blanking on the artist. Excuse me.
Oh, it's Lori something, isn't it?
Lea Salonga. Sorry.
Yes.
Lea Salonga. She voiced Mulan's singing voice and Jasmine's.
And Pocahontas, right?
It was Judy Kuhn that was Pocahontas.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I get all of these girls, I get them mixed up. The icons of the Disney Renaissance princess era and how they all sing multiple different things. I keep getting them confused. Yes.
Goodness. But yes, Reflection for me is, that's my number 7.
Okay. How about you? See, I'm getting into some tougher areas because there are a lot of songs that I really, really love. And for number 7, I think I'm going to have, this is going to be another really, really deep cut. However, this is on my Dapper playlist. This is on my Disney favorites playlist. It is a song from a Disneyland Parks album. That I think there's only a CD version of it.
So ready. I had multiple of those.
Do you have multiple? Let's see if you even know this one. The song is called Let's Dance at Disneyland.
Whoa. No, I don't know that one.
Okay. This is such a niche song. It is performed by the Elliott Brothers. They were the band that played when they did the swing dancing over in that little area over there, and they had the band. The song... Oh, Chris, I think we might have to actually get a clip out of this song if we're able to. But it literally talks about, is the ad. It is the ad song for Let's Dance at Disneyland. Fireworks are great at Disneyland. And it goes through the hours of the park and like Friday nights, Friday, oh my gosh, just fantastic song. So whenever I associate with Dapper Day or dressing up, this is the song I associate it with Disneyland. And I loved this song before I even went to Disneyland. And that's I don't know amazing. How I found this. Either I stumbled across the CD and maybe I borrowed it from the library and I pulled the songs and put it on my MP3 player. I think that's how I found it. And then to come across it years later on Spotify, and I'm like, oh, wow, we're adding this to the playlist. And it's one that I will always turn on and I will always play. But that super, super niche song. And I am so sorry, y'all, if you do not know this song.
Do you want to hear it?
Yeah, I want to hear it. Do you have it up?
I got everything.
Chris, it's you're so good. Date night
at Disneyland with the Elliott Brothers and the Disneyland Date Nighters. Let's dance.
I'm over here dancing right now.
Let's dance at Disneyland. Date nights are late nights at Disneyland.
We're open till the clock rocks.
1 a.m. Friday and Saturday nights.
It's literally an ad for Disneyland from the 50s.
Under a million twinkling lights, Friday and Saturday nights, dance slow.
And then it goes through the different types of songs that they play on the bandstand. And then
rock and roll.
Rock and roll. Isn't that great?
That's so good.
Thank you, Chris. Okay. That made this whole entire podcast. That was fantastic.
That was awesome. And yes, okay, I totally have heard that song before. I love that.
But isn't that song very on brand for me, though?
I was about to say, Danielle, that is so you. And I think it's great. Absolutely
I think it definitely encapsulates the dapper Danielle brand and the dapper lifestyle. Mm-hmm. I think it definitely is the highlight song. So it is the ad for Disneyland, but it's also the ad for the dapper Danielle brand.
I think it could be your theme song. Definitely.
For sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. I think we got one more before we leave them on a cliffhanger and I leave them with more obscure songs for my top five.
Yes. This is the cap for the episode. We have number 6 in our top 10. And mine, I don't think it comes to surprise that this one would be in my top 10. It's Eye to Eye from the Goofy movie. I don't think I realized
how much you like a Goofy movie. I didn't think you were a Goofy movie gal for some reason.
Oh, Danielle.
okay.
On repeats on VHS in my household for...
Really?
A certain period of time. Oh, yes. Goofy Movie 2. Yeah. So Eye to Eye, Powerline is, again, it's one when it comes up on the shuffle for the Disney playlist, it blasts in my car every single time because it's so good. Eye to Eye is number 6 for me.
See, mm-hmm. I don't know why I never watched a Goofy movie when I was younger. I did not actually appreciate a Goofy movie until I worked in children's activities. And it was one of the movies that we played on the lawn in the evenings and just happened to be on one night. And I would just stand there because you had to watch the screen. You had to watch the people. And we'd be watching the movie at the same time. I'm like, oh, this is great. This is actually fantastic. And so I didn't really enjoy it until I was much older, at least 19 or 20. I don't know. I didn't grow up with it the same way that you did.
That is really interesting. And I knew that there were obviously going to be some differences in the list, but also just what we grew up with. So that definitely impacts what we put in our top 10.
Oh, absolutely.
So that's good to know. Yeah. All right. So before you hear our number 6 in our top 10 Disney songs, make sure that you subscribe if you're not subscribed already. Make sure to rate and review the show. And if you want to hear our 11 through 15, be sure to subscribe to our Patreon. Yes. Where you'll hear more of our favorite Disney songs.
So that way you can get even more very weird, obscure Disney songs that are also on Danielle's playlist. And
that's right.
It'll just be more of a deep cut. It'll be, it'll be so interesting.
And of course, make sure to follow us on social media at Disney Countdown Show.
Absolutely. Yes, for sure. Or leave a comment. Let us know if you agreed earlier with what we said about, you agree with Billboard's 100 or you're like, absolutely not. I do not agree with Billboard's 100. So now that everybody is following, subscribed, rated, reviewed, and whatnot, I am ready to give y'all my top six. And I think, Chris, you might need to be on the ready again because it's another deep cut. It is the Spectrum song from Wonderful World of Color.
Wow.
Yeah. Ooh, you've heard the song, correct?
I have undoubtedly heard this song. Could I name the title of the song? Probably not, but I believe I've heard this song.
The Spectrum song is sung by the character Professor Ludwig von Drake, right? And it comes from the Wonderful World of Color series, and this first premiered when Wonderful World of Color became a thing, and it switched from ABC to NBC because NBC was one of the only places that showed TV in color. And so this was very drama back in the day also, but to really showcase this in the first episode and show all the different versions of color and art and whatnot on television, they created the Spectrum song. And it's Ludwig von Drake and his little goofy little accent singing red, yellow, green, red, blue, 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 red, purple, green, yellow, orange, red, red. And is hilarious. And another deep dive song for a lot of people, but so many people don't know this song. But whenever this comes on and it just circles through randomly on my playlist, I will stop. And I'm just like, turn that knob up a little bit louder. And I'm blaring this with the windows rolling down and everybody's looking around. Somebody drives up to me at the red light and just turns off to the left and is just like, what on earth is that chick listening to? It is the Spectrum song. It's more likely what it is.
That is just the whole, Danielle, your whole list is fantastic. And so just amazing to me. I can say these are songs that I haven't thought of in years or really like knew the name of, you know? So
right. And see, this is, and that's so interesting of like, again, a lot of my stuff comes from my random deep dives in Disney history and like re-pulling this out and where, I don't know, it's cool to see all the different like nuances.
Yeah.
Yes. Chris, really, do you have the song so that way people can hear a clip of it so they know what the heck I'm talking about?
Yes, I have the song.
Oh, magical.
Red, yellow, green, red, blue, blue.
I'm over here like bopping.
Yellow, orange, red, 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 yellow, green, red, blue, 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 red, purple, green, yellow, orange, red, red. Blend them up and what do you
blend them up and what do you get?
Mauve, beige, and ultramarine, and
beige and ultramarine
in between. Hazo, kawaii, kai, non,
so niche, right?
Color has its harmony, and just like I have said,
it is magical.
What?
Again, this is so, I'm sorry, y'all. Continuing into this next season of Disney Countdown, you're going to learn so much of obscure Disney-ness, just Disney in general, that you might not have known about until I've joined into this podcast. Megan's going to be the only sane, logical one talking about like a lot of like nostalgia pieces and like all these other great little Disney tidbits. Nope, Danielle's coming at you with a Spectrum song. It's only going to get weirder from there. And
we have such a good balance though.
That really
just
do.
Then it just works. We yin and yang complement each other very well.
You know what? It just keeps it spicy. It just keeps it interesting. Now, if you want to do homework and you want to look into something very interesting, look up the album. There is an actual album record that you can play from. It's on Spotify, the entire thing, from beginning to end. And it is called literally Professor Ludwig von Drake. Just search it. And you start with the first one, which is he has his own theme song. It's called I'm Ludwig von Drake. And he talks at you as if you're listening to the actual vinyl record and you flip it over and he's like yelling at the band and he's like making all these sound effects with the band and whatnot. And he's like, what are you doing? And it's great. It is a fantastic just to turn it on and have it play and just listen to the absurdity and craziness that it is. It is fantastic.
That's amazing.
Megan, I like I said, it's just going to get weirder from here.
Bring it on.
Yes.
Okay. Bring on the weirdness.
Well, we're going to have, okay, I won't dive into the five because we got to save our last five through one for the next episode.
All right. Well, we've come to the end here, friends, of our premiere episode. So thank you all so much for joining us.
We just finished recording our first episode.
This is our first one. That's crazy.
This is so crazy.
And so much fun.
And you know what? It's just going to be even more interesting, even more deep dives from here on out. And I can't wait to cover even more topics. It's just so exciting. Everything's so exciting. Yes.
It's going to be a blast. Yes, we got 1 through 5 of our top 10 Disney songs coming at you next week. So stay tuned for that. Be sure to subscribe once again. And I'm super excited to finish out this list. It's going to be awesome.
It will be awesome.
So yeah,
for sure.
We'll see you guys next week. Thank you so much for joining us. And
what is our
sign off? We got to sign off the show somehow.
You
have your catchphrase.
I do have my catchphrase. And I do feel like that, again, we're talking very on brand for the Dapper Danielle, as we're talking about, like, my other songs are very on brand. I feel like it's very on brand for me to say my sign off, which is the night, night, sleep tight, dream of churros tonight. But how are we going to blend this in to match with you too, Megan?
Mine is always just, you know, mine's have a magical day.
Let's work on this. Send us off.
All right. So thank you all so much for joining us once again, and have a magical day, friends.
And also, night, night, sleep tight, dream of churros tonight. That's it. It's in the books. Wrap it up, people.